What's up, guys? It's Fuad for Viper Visions. We're here, Punch and Munch, episode 2. And before I introduce our special guest today, make sure to stay tuned to our channel and subscribe to get all the latest videos that we are releasing. We've got a lot of plans for 2019, from fan cams to more Punch and Munch episodes to Jacob's Corner talking all football. We've got the 12th man series coming where we're going to go into a football team. We're going to go behind the scenes. We're going to see all sorts of stuff that's not seen before. So make sure to stay tuned to that as well. Make sure to hit that notification bell to stay up to date with whatever we post, because listen, we're taking over the game here. Well, today's guests, we've got two huge names, both domestically and definitely one worldwide. The WBC Flyweight Champion of the World, the WBO International Champion. It's the Edward brothers, Sonny and Charlie. Whoa.
What you call an icon living? Start a record label, Misfits just did it. Nylon, cover 5 minutes. Whoa, we are too hot in the business. About to make a movie independent. Need new trucks independent. I need you to listen to the vision. All your verses sound like dirty dishes. I'm about to clean them in the kitchen. And we making money by the minute. I'm about to do a way different. I am just an icon living.
I am just an icon living. Living. Icon living.
Over the last 2 years since I got beat from Casemiro, I've gone through windy, bendy, bumps in the road, all over the place.
Yep.
Had to reassess things, had to learn how to make decisions for myself, how to become a man.
I have looked fragile.
I sat down for the first time in my whole career. There was no way I was ever looking for a way out. I weren't losing to him, not looking for a way out no matter what.
That naive and arrogant that you think you're the finished article, you're never the finished article. Yep. You're going and challenging yourself at the best level and you lose. Simply the fact is, you're not good enough. So what do you have to do to get good enough? I believed in myself and I believed I can rule supreme now. The world's our oysters and we can go all the way. We're only going to limit ourselves. I dare to be great. A lot of people wouldn't dare to be brave. We push each other, we try and outshine each other day in, day out in the gym, and we'll be all the way and we'll go to the top together.
The boxing scheduled for the WBC Flyweight Championship of the World!
This here is all about my wife, my kids, the life that I live. I was his, it was right, what I did. My ups and downs, my slips, my falls, my trials and tribulations, my heart, my balls.
I build a legacy and I want to retire from the sport later on in life and be, I had done everything. I didn't shy away from nothing. I faced everything. As long as I keep believing, as long as I keep training hard, as long as I keep listening to Grant and learning, the future is going to be bright.
Guys, you've seen our two guests today, Sonny and Charlie Edwards. What a month it's been for you two.
Yeah, it's been a good end to the year, to be honest. Yeah. Even a bit more than a month, obviously, my Farag fight leading on straight into the next camp. I got to defend my title, my European title, and then pick up the international one, which boosted my world ranking. Obviously, Charlie going on to win the world title, which is sort of blows all mine out the water.
We've got Sonny's title here.
Yeah, so one I just won against Junior Granados, who, like, his record probably doesn't do him justice. He beat Pasite, who drew against Donny Nietz for the world version of WBO Super Flyweight. So he's a good level fighter. He gave Jamie Conlon hell as well. So picking up Farag and Granados on my record in quick succession, you know, two hard 10-round fights, has put me in a great place for 2019. Obviously, I sustained an injury in my last fight in the second round. That's annoying, but it's not like a career ending or nothing like that. So gullet in the boot now on the crutches, just letting it repair, mend, and then smashed the rest of 2019.
Yeah. Was there any point in that fight, you know, because it went so early, the injury, but did doubts ever, we know you're a confident guy, but did doubts ever creep in? So not necessarily lose, but maybe save it for another day or something.
I think if you watch it back, which obviously I have done, you see I get caught with like a little flash shot on the side of the head that I didn't really see coming, so I sort of half pulled away from it. And the way I fell, because my weight went down, it went all over my ankle, and I was up by the second, like I was straight up. And you can see me sort of like have like a little wince and like a little hobble as soon as I jump up, because I put my weight on my right foot. So I didn't feel it go, but I felt it straight after. But I came out and I put it straight on him, to be honest. Obviously I did feel it, yeah. and I couldn't really put weight on it. That's why I boxed a lot of the next few rounds southpaw. And I sat down, not after the round I got put down when it happened, I sat down for the first time in my whole career, and that's amateurs, pros. I've never sat in between a round after the third round, because I thought, oh, that might be better for it. Then I stood up and it hurt more, you know, because I took the weight off and then put it back on, it hurt more, so I just sort of I carried on standing the rest of the fight. And yeah, I got through it, you know what I mean? There was no way I was ever looking for a way out. Like, I weren't losing to him, or, you know, I mean, if I'm losing, someone's taking me out there or beating me convincingly. I'm not looking for a way out no matter what.
It's not just boxing terms in your family that's been sort of what's been going on. You've had a child as well?
Yeah, yeah. Ten days before that fight, actually. He was due on the... I'm going to get bollock forgetting this wrong. 26.
He was
due on site, like the 25th or 26th he was due. Yeah. I think 25th, actually.
Yeah.
And it was 10 days late. I took the Granados fight at 4.5 weeks' notice. I hadn't trained for 2.5 weeks.
Yeah.
And I took it at 4.5 weeks' notice.
Balls of steel.
Well, nah, you've got to seize these opportunities, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it went from not getting a TV slot, which at that time, really, I hadn't deserved. I hadn't had any fights that deserved to be on TV instead of anyone else.
Yeah.
My amateur background was good, not the greatest. So, it's not unrealistic. Then I got my chance headlining Box Nation.
Yeah.
Boxed very well. You know what I mean? I'm very convincing in what was supposed to be a hard fight. And then I got the BT co-main feature. Obviously, it worked out of that because of the pullouts. But, and now that's boosting my record up again, my stock up again. So, would I do it again? Yeah. Maybe not being as conditioned as I could been. Maybe that played a part of my ankle. I don't really think so, though, because it was kind of like a freak.
Yeah. I mean, if it was when you went down, it's just a waste of things.
Yeah, that's when it was, yeah. So, but it's like I said, I still got through it. More annoying that now I've got to have a little bit of time out, because even though it shouldn't have really happened, I've sort of promised two more fight dates.
Yeah.
Obviously, win, and win.
Yeah.
But two more title fights in March and May, BT shows, you know what I mean? So that's more frustrating that, like, I was looking at that, I got through my two fights, and that would have been a good run. But now we're still looking at the May one, like, I'll be 100% fine by then. But I think now instead of the March, it'll be like early April, but in like a 6 or 8 rounder, just coming back into it. Yeah, because I've already started, know my sort of like my strength training, my upper body's training. You know, just keep conditioned. Well, over the Christmas period, I've sort of let that go a little bit. But yeah, I need to stay in the gym. Yeah. I mean, our gym's just got a new whole strength and conditioning.
I've seen that. That looks tops. It looks right. I mean, it was a good gym regardless, but I think one of the things is a bit cut off at that edge that they've opened up now, but that's just made it even 10 times better.
The gym weren't recognised because Grant's done all the amateur. He's come from grassroots and smashed all the amateurs, all national champions. And he... even his son, Dalton Smith, has come all the way from a young baby all the way up to some fighting on GB, and he's one of the most rated. I rate him one of the most on that squad.
Definitely.
And now he's got Sonny. Sonny was his first pro.
Well, we had Scott Jenkins.
He had Scott Jenkins, which he made a lot of noise with. And then Sonny was his second pro then, and he's been with him for 5 years, from the amateurs all the way through. And you just have to see his ability, what he does, and how he boxes, and the technique he has. And now I've been with him 12 months, but I've worked with him before quite a bit as well. And I decided to move to Sheffield, and now he's getting the notice and the recognition for what he deserves. The guy is so obsessed with boxing, and he just wants to give the boxer 110% undivided attention. And he don't want nothing out of it. Obviously, he gets paid, but his dream and goal is to become this big time coach with match proper elite fighters who are champions and prove everyone who's doubted him, like people doubt us, we're on the same kind of journey and we're all pushing for the top, and that's what makes it so special. Grant's biggest fight, biggest night to date, when I had my biggest fight, biggest night to date, we come together and we proved everyone who thought we was going to lose. We wanted to go into a fight as an underdog, a big fight. That's his been his dream. Yeah. We went into that fight as a big underdog. People were saying they're going to knock me out and stuff like this, and we proved all the doubters wrong. And that's what we're in this to do, keep proving them wrong, keep making a career, making a legacy and pushing forward. And that man there is a very, very special coach. And more people want to be coming with him.
It's not. People are finally seeing what I've been saying for years. Yeah, ever since I went with him. Do you know what I mean? Because, like, yeah, where I'm outspoken, even though I haven't been fighting on live TV, I've built a fairly good profile.
Through your social media.
Yeah, that through, but through ability as well, for amateur background, for everything. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Through being Charlie Edwards' brother. Do you know what I mean? A bit of everything. But now there's obviously they're not people that don't know too much about boxing, but it's like, oh. When I left Danny Vaughan, because when I turned pro, I couldn't train with Grant and him do the amateurs, and because he obviously got his son and has a whole squad. Like, people don't realise, when I was an amateur with him, I moved up here first from uni.
Yeah.
There's one year he had, let's just talk about the open fighters, he had four enter, which was me, Janaid Boston, Dalton Smith and Chris Ateki. I won the senior A-Bays that year. Dalton and Chris won the youths, and Janaid won, I think, the schools or the juniors. But at four entries, he had four national champions. And how often does that happen? And if you add the novices on that same year, he had Dan Levi, Kinsiona, both entered, both won. Like, everyone that entered won a national title. And he only has a squad. The squad's got a little bit bigger now. He's gone full-time, but it's gone from, like, having 10 boxers carded to having about 15. And at that season, when I first joined, that first, say, 24 months before I turned pro, every kid in there was a national champion. Every single kid, obviously novices as well, senior ABAs and all the way through. So he's just showing what he's been proving for a long time. But obviously you don't get the recognition as an amateur, but what I like about Grant is he's been patient with his amateurs, he's fed them through, and now he's starting to reap rewards as a pro coach. Yep. Too many people, you know, try and jump straight into the pros, try and grab all, try and say they reinvented the wheel. But the best thing is, really, he's very open to learning, studying the game. And it, like Charlie just said, he puts 110%, and you feel that as a when we're getting up at 6:30 in the morning to go hit track, and we know that there's no chance of him not being there or him cancelling the night before, because it's not his personality. I mean, if it was up to him, we'd be there at 5:00 in the morning. Do you know what I mean?
Even if it's raining. Yeah. Even if it's raining, someone would say, "I'll just do your track on the treadmill and not turn up." He's there on the treadmill.
He's there. If he comes down to the gym on the
making
treadmill,
sure we're doing it. He's there every step of the way. Rings you on a daily basis. Watches you like a hawk. And to have that love and that support, undivided attention that every fighter needs. And he hasn't got any hidden agendas. He hasn't got his mind on all these other businesses, this and that. He loves boxing, and he's strictly divided and devoted to making champions. And that's his passion.
Do you know what? And take away just me and Charlie, because obviously me and Charlie, even though we've changed a lot, I've changed a hell of a lot, hell of a lot. And so has Charlie since we've been working with Grant. Yep. Obviously, I've been a bit longer. If you look at the other lads in the gym, and he's a very good friend of mine, a classmate of my brother, but if you look at a Christian Kinsiona, who went from drawing against a journeyman and losing to Scott Westgarth, RIP, he took him from that, losing four rounders on the small hall shows, and
the weight as well.
Well, he's went from a heavyweight.
He was
then down cruiserweight, and now he's fighting down at super middle.
Super middle.
Even then, there's a potential of him getting down to middle if, because he's not the tallest. But he's been looking better and better and better. He had a hard fight against Harry Matthews, but it was his first 10-rounder, and he was not 100% fit going into that. He had little niggles, but it was a great opportunity for him, and it worked out. Do you know what I mean? That's Christian Kinsiona, who started boxing late, would have got writ off and probably told to go straight down the journeyman route at probably following his loss.
Yeah.
And now changed trainer. He's dropped about 3 weight classes and he's won a central area title out of really. And I don't think he'll be mad at me saying it, out of nothing, really.
Yeah.
And then Levi and Dan, obviously Levi's a pro now.
Yeah.
Levi's 3-0.
And he's making a name for himself.
Yeah, and he stopped at Fons, who had the week before boxed GB lads and went the distance with, and kids that toured the world. and Levi stopped him in like the first.
And he looks a lot like, for someone who's only had three fights, he looks very, very, very comfortable in a ring.
He's a very confident lad, you know what I mean? He lives with me, so it sort of rubs off. You know what I mean? Like,
Sunny ain't shy of confidence.
Showing him the ways of the Jedi. But he's a very confident lad in and outside the ring, and it shows. You don't lose your personality. Yeah, you don't lose your personality too much in the ring from out of it. Yeah. I think you can. That's a lot of time the case for a lot of fighters. But yeah, obviously he's still very raw as a pro. Do you know what I mean? He's not going to be, I don't know, doing like what me and Charlie did and jumping from 4 rounders quick to 6 rounders and 10-round title fights.
Yep.
He's going to have to be a lot slower. Yep. He's building his name up on the small hall circuit, and that's how he's going to have to be. He's going to have to build a nice record, get the experience. But he's fighting the harder journeyman. Like, he's not fighting the easy. He's not fighting the ones he's just rolling over straight off.
The last one he fought, actually, at Doncaster. Yeah.
Tough. Very tough. And goes distance with a lot of good prospects. And obviously, at the moment, Levi's obviously very down the ladder. You know, even though he won national title, like, novices and got to, like, the semis of whatever, he weren't coming off GB, so you've got to take that into consideration. But you know what I mean? He puts the work and he puts the hours in, so hopefully that can be another one. And also you've got Carl Youssef as well, who just won the English title. Obviously Carl came from the Ingles as a good fighter, do you know what I mean?
But that goes to show, if he's come from the Ingle gym, which is recognised as one of the best gyms in England, and you've come out of the booth, yeah.
Well, it's...
Talks for itself.
If Grant is going to... Obviously... Grant doesn't approach no one. He would never go, "Oh, drop me to train," or sort of thing. That's just not his way inclined. But if someone comes to him, if he didn't think for a second that he could, one, dedicate 100% time to you, two, be able to prioritise you enough, like, don't get me wrong, Charlie at the moment would have to be the world champion, do you know what I mean? Yeah. So he's the priority. Then you've got, obviously, me fighting for international titles. Then, so it kind of slips down, do you know what I mean? And that's the way it has to be. If someone's fighting a 12-round thing, they're going to have to be that priority just in... But if he can't scale it down right, he's turned good fighters down.
But Grant isn't greedy. He ain't going to take on loads of fighters to get that paycheck. He wants a small number of fighters who he can devote his untold attention to and make them all champions. Yeah. And that's what a good man he is.
Charlie, I want to speak about, obviously, there's one thing to speak about right now with the hottest topic. Just before we speak about...
How did you feel watching me win the WBC?
Yeah, how did you? I'm joking. 22nd December, biggest night of your life. But let's talk about, I mean, we've heard you in the interviews talk about the build-up and stuff. Emotionally, the real inside of you, that week following up to it, for everything that's gone down to it, you've not even had 20 fights. Take us through the raw emotion of actually leading up to that, man, because it was an emotional night for a lot of people that night.
It's a hard one, like, and I could sit here and talk for an hours on it, but... Over the last 2 years since I got beat from Casemiro, I've gone through windy, bendy, bumps in the road, all over the place.
Yep.
Had to reassess things, had to learn how to make decisions for myself, how to become a man.
Like, being written off.
Yeah, I mean, written off on a number
after those
of occasions.
Two 8-rounders.
Yeah.
It's funny, a year ago, people was laughing, saying his career's finished. Especially after you left Adam Booth, Adam Booth, don't even want to know more, his career's finished, da da da. And then that short period of time, and now all of a sudden...
Number one flyweight in the world, wow. That is crazy.
It's good, it feels good, but to be honest, it don't feel no different.
Yeah.
I'm a realist, I'm humble. I've still got loads to learn in this game.
100%.
And I didn't come in this game just to become a world champion.
Yep.
I'm obsessed with bettering myself, pushing the limits, and I want to build a legacy, and I want to retire from the sport later on in life. And B, I had done everything. I didn't shy away from nothing. I faced every fear, and touch wood, I overcome every fear. But it's a long game. But I ain't in it to pick and choose who I fight like certain champions. We know who they are. I ain't gonna mention their names. And I'm here to fight the best and the best. I want unifications next.
Yep.
Straight into unification if I can against that Mifflay Maruti. He wants to unify against me, so makes a perfect opportunity and fight. I'm not sure about what's going on in the contract about a rematch clause or anything. I'm sure I'll sit down with Eddie and we'll come together and try and work something out with my management team, MTK. So, that's where I'm at now. I'm world champion now, but it was hard work getting here, but now it's where the hard work starts.
Yeah.
I'm not satisfied. I woke up the next day, I'm world champion. I'm walking around, everyone's saying world champion. Doesn't feel like I'm world champion, if that makes sense. I'm the same person 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Right, I've won the belt, but now what's next? I'm one of them ones. I don't sit around on the fence, want to be having loads of time off, putting myself backwards. I've had so much hardship going through my career and not getting the fights I wanted.
Yep.
After that Casemiro fight, I think I had two eight rounders. I fought Butcher for the British, and then I fought Nelson. So I had four fights.
You had the comeback fight, which was what, a six rounder.
Oh yeah, six rounder, two eights.
And I did the Butcher fight. And
the
then
Butcher fights, then 2 8 rounders.
Nelson fight was only three.
Then Nelson, it went 3 rounds, but it was supposed to be a 10 round contest for the WBA Intercontinental. Yeah. So I've had a lot of hardship in my career, but I've got to take that as just grateful, being grateful for that, because really, if I didn't and I was jumping into these fights, maybe I wouldn't be world champion right now. I needed to get with the right people. I chose to jump ship and go with Grant. He's changed me as a fighter. You see little bits, a glimpse of it in the Nelson fight, but I really didn't get to show it. Then we had some more time to work together, and then that we really developed, and he changed me. He changed the way I thought about the sport of boxing. It changed the reason why I used to throw loads of punches, like ridiculous amounts, and he slowed me down. He got my footwork right, because everyone said I had great footwork, but reality was I was
just
good
quick.
And quick,
yeah.
But I was doing a lot of mistakes.
Very clumsy,
and I weren't developing power, and I weren't being able to keep world level opposition off because my feet weren't planted. But
that's
at the right
why there was
time.
There was a lot of questions before of your defence and
yeah.
people not maybe fragile, but suggesting something along those lines, just because.
But I have looked fragile, so
you'd get caught up in your feet, and because you'd try and be too positive.
And I'd swing.
And then you'd get caught, even like when Craig Derbyshire was going all hectic
yeah.
and that. It's
yeah,
like.
Yeah.
Like, you know, trying to get away from, but
yeah.
it's if when you like watch them and you sort of like take a step back, and then every sort of time there's a bit of danger, you disengage. If you keep that
yeah.
rhythm and that routine of disengaging, then the opportunities they make themselves. Like
yeah.
look at when you're caught with an uppercut, you just step back, boom,
that
and then caught.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
that's just that was the best
shot
of the fight, 100%. But
what,
it came off.
When I watched that slow motion, yeah.
I remember
when I went back to the corner, I'm sitting there and the whole crowd go, ooh, and I was like, yes, it must have been that shot I caught him with. I watched it slow motion, and I've got to give it to Rosales. He is one tough, fit man because people look at how I hit Nelson with that uppercut and look how I put him away. And many people that took that uppercut wouldn't have carried on coming. He took the uppercut, stepped forward and threw back at me.
Yeah.
I was like, what is going on?
You know what,
though?
You can't.
Like, he's a good, very good, tough fighter.
You don't do these South Americans to the head. You just have the body.
They're too tough, man. They've got a hard life. They ain't
yeah, the shots bounce
off their
head. They hurt your hand more.
Look, I think your career is in so many terms positive because. The way you look at it, how many fights is it with Grant? Three, four now?
No, two.
Just two. Okay, so the two fights. Within them two fights, he's changed you as a fighter, like you said. You're sitting on your shots more, from what I've seen. So if you've won a world title against a very tough champion, when you're not even at your best yet,
I've still got another.
Not physically. It's not about you reaching your peak. If you're not even at your best yet with Grant. He's still got stuff to teach you and things. Oh, well, there you go.
But we're like that. We're both like them fighters that, right, I've won the world title. I'm on the phone to Grant all the time speaking about how I can better myself, how if the rematch does come off, how we're going to beat him.
Yeah.
We're both obsessed and both on it. I've already been back running. I've already been in the gym.
Yeah.
I only fought, what, how many days ago?
Like 2 weeks.
20 seconds.
2 weeks right, tomorrow, isn't it?
Yeah, 2 weeks tomorrow. I've been running.
Yeah.
I've been training in the gym. I just want to better myself every day, and if you come at this sport with that mentality, like, you never stop learning, and that's the truth of it, you never stop learning. As soon as you think you stop learning, you might as well walk away from this sport, because there's always someone out there who's going to learn more and going to better themselves.
Definitely.
If you really are that naive and arrogant that you think you're the finished article, you're never the finished article.
Yeah.
Never.
But the second thing I was going to say as well is, think about how you took that Casemiro fight after nine, was it?
That was my ninth fight.
Yeah, ninth fight. With minimum almost experience in the pro game and building that up. It's a bit like, I'm going to give you a good example, but I mean, he's not won a world title or anything, but Dave Allen, look at the way he's done what he's done so far.
Yeah,
he's fought tough. Yeah, but he's fought, it's not just his personality, let's forget about his personality. He's fought tough opponents in his first, bunch of fights. So now he's just going to get better and better because he's got that game experience against Luis Ortiz, Dylan White.
The way I see it, when I got that shot, I called for it. I dared to be great.
Yeah.
A lot of people wouldn't dare to be great, and they could waste their whole career, and then they get to the last hurdle and they fall.
Yeah.
I would rather lose early, not worry about all the hype. The hype goes away from you. It's been hard, yeah. but it's made me the man I am today. Yeah. And I always say it, and I always say, records are for DJs, and that's it.
Like
you're fighters.
Yep.
If you're going and challenging yourself at the best level and you lose, simply the fact is you're not good enough. So what do you have to do to get good enough? And that's what this game's about. Too many people duck and dive and don't want to fight. And obviously I understand if this money situation and you know you can fight someone for bigger money in a couple of years, but too many people are handpicking opponents. Too many champions, world champions, are fighting people. And no one even knows who they are. They're not ranked.
One of the things that pisses me off.
It's like, what's the point of being a world champion if you're going to fight ranked 48?
Yeah. 100%.
What's the point?
No. Well, then again, Rosales did that too, and you fucked him, didn't you?
Yeah, that's why, I suppose.
But, like I was going to say.
Hey, I was ranked 48, weren't I?
I'd be a bit higher, maybe.
Were you 48th?
I think 38th, I think it was.
In the world?
Yeah,
I'm boxing,
I think.
And now you're first.
I kind of did that. You ain't even boxed in fucking flyweight for about 3 years.
I took out the top dog. That's how I done that.
I bet he's sat at home and he's thinking, well, can I take that fight?
Yeah, no. He asked ridiculous money for it. Cause
and he got it.
Because they offered him and he said no. And then they come back with big money. And Eddie, to be fair to him, got my shot.
Yeah.
And he took it.
It paid off.
Yeah.
The thing about, like, we talk about records and stuff, and I say it all the time, when you compare boxing and like high class MMA, sort of like UFC and stuff like that. But it's annoying because when someone loses in any sort of MMA organization, it's not necessarily the end of their career. It's almost like Mayweather effect. I always say it.
It's how it affects your pride, your mental state of mind, and how, like, if some people could lose and they would never be able to recover from it, but that shows a lot more about that person. And they're the people who are going to dodge, duck, and dive, and really. British public, especially in this day and age, everyone's fighting everyone now. And the ones that ain't are making a fool of themselves, and the British public are turning away from them.
Well, because that's what it is. It's people are, the fighters are scared, you know, to open up Twitter and sort of get butchered or seeing a picture and get laid out. And that's what it is. That's why a lot of times people
don't take.
Yeah,
it's sad doing it.
But the only way
you're. It's a sport.
The thing is, if I'm going to come up against someone, say if I had an opponent for next year. Yeah. And there was an opponent that had like a wicked record, you know what I mean, been in a couple of fights, but had vastly built his career just on the back of sort of like tin cans. I'd rather fight him than fight the one that's got a couple of losses but been in proper fights, because you don't improve. Do you know when at some of my fights as a pro, I could have beat him on 20 or maybe 15% of what I can do. So therefore I'm not going to stimulate myself physically and mentally to get up to that them high percentages. But now I've been through the rounds, I've like Farag, much more experienced than me. People were saying I was crazy. He was coming down a weight. Do you know what I mean? He was former European champion. Why am I taking that fight? Junior Granados really should have beat Conlon. A lot of people said. Even Frank Warren's journalist team put out before the fight that Conlon beat him in controversial circumstances. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it was.
But that's neither here nor there. I'm not a judge, so I don't really care. But a lot of people thinking, hold on, why is Sonny? He's just come off. When I boxed Farag, I think it was the same weekend or the weekend after, he beat someone 16-0 with a draw from Mexico, Rocky Mex, whatever his name is, was high ranked. Like, why is Sonny fighting him at 4.5 weeks' notice? You know what I mean? But because I believe in myself that much, that I knew that that level's not beating me. You know what I mean? Even when things went really bad, you know what I mean, I got put down,
that's what you
down up my leg.
For. You might get hate and this and that beforehand, but as soon as you've seen it, at the back of the Ryan Farag fight, everyone giving it, you're going to get this, you're going to get that. Oh, now they're fans. The haters have turned fans.
Oh, I've had so many people that's turned from.
Haters, it's not that they're fans, but now they're like, you know what, I used to think Sonny Edwards was the right arrogant, this, that and the other. But you know what, he can fight. And when you're doing that to people, you're winning.
Well, that's the
I've had
so many
career.
People.
That's a legacy.
I've had so many people, especially from the Farag fight, because obviously that was a...
Needle.
Because there was so much needle involved. You either, I don't know, okay, there was a lot of people down the middle, but... Because there was a lot to have an opinion on. It was either I want Sonny Edwards to win or I want Ryan Farag to win. And I've had a hell of a lot, probably more than I could even like care to like number people that have gone, either I wanted you to get knocked out or I thought you was going to, or I thought you was da-da-da, who now are messaging me good luck before my next fight, and when are you fighting again? Like, and that's only good for my app, but that's only good for your profile.
Exactly.
Because if you have 10,000 people that know you, say in boxing, 5,000 want you to do well, 5,000 that don't, if you keep doing well, them 5,000 that know you and then start actually enjoying it, they're going to come over. Obviously,
well,
you're
long term as well, because ones that don't like you, they'll tune into
thing
what's
is, you're not
going
to. Thing is, I could cure cancer tomorrow and someone will find a negative thing and why I couldn't do it sooner. Do you know what I mean? We live in a negative world.
And that's just jealousy.
So it's very easy to be negative because back in the day with Fuad and all the internet and that, to be negative, you'd have to have the balls to stand up in front of someone and say it. Otherwise, you wouldn't hear what they say. Now, everyone's got an opinion, it's so easy just to type things.
Well, everyone's got something to say, but the way I see it is, if you don't allow someone's what they're saying to affect you, who cares? Who's going to listen to someone's talking negative? No. The only people that are going to listen and want to feed off that are more negative people. And you know what? They can stay in their own lane because they're not going nowhere. We'll go in our lane and we'll keep proving doubters wrong, keep stepping up and up.
You've
and
gotta
it
have,
is.
You've got to have it.
That's sport. That's sport.
What are you going to do with all the people that like it? It's great, but that's in real terms, it's like a movie term. You need.
There's like in football, a player never gets booed. Yeah. That's just an average, mediocre, just team player.
Exactly.
But say if the star man gets past it, everyone, like, do you know what I mean? Everyone, obviously on the other team.
And as soon as someone fails that is up there and they do a little thing wrong, and everyone's only human. Sportsmen only human. Everyone's human. You make mistakes in life, but it's when you make the mistakes, and you know you're successful when you make the mistakes and people are on you, hounding you. And you just got to take it with a pinch of salt and not. But I don't even really use Twitter. I can't be arsed with it. Twitter is negative. Yeah. Negative energy, and I don't need to see what people are saying or saying. You do get some good on there, and you do get good
the
comments.
Worst is definitely the YouTube comments, though, isn't it?
I don't even look at them anymore. Wow.
YouTube comments, they're funny.
Listen, I ain't nowhere near big or anything, but when I've done anything for behind the gloves, the comments
just horrible,
isn't it? Is unreal.
I think that I film are the most toxic.
Oh yeah, mate, trust me. But it's cool, you know what? I like it in some terms.
It makes me laugh. I sit there and read them all.
When I'm live on Behind the Gloves,
you take
I'll
that negative and turn it into
people
positive.
When I call you the world's ugliest man.
Well, I don't know who does that.
Listen, I'll fight you for that belt. I'm joking now. I'll avoid that. I'll fight you while you've got that one.
Oh, I reckon I'd still have that. I saw you shadow boxing the other day.
Yeah, mate, it's good. Listen, I can move. I got a few moves up my sleeve.
That's it.
I take inspiration from Mr. Charlie Edwards over there. Tells me to improve. Listen, your social medias are so different. You've got.
Yeah. That's what it
you've
is.
Got, you've
he
got
thinks
the...
he's Mahatma Gandhi reinventing the world. Like, Jesus Christ.
No, I just thought.
But I like it. I like it.
I mean, I'm here to. You like, got, I've listen. Got a voice, so now I'm trying to inspire the young generation. I remember being that young generation.
Amigos sorting us out as always. Listen, the food here.
Banging. Banging. I'll be coming back, that's for sure. First time I've eaten here.
Touching your nutrition, I mean, obviously you're loving this, but when you're in camp.
Yeah, when I'm in camp, I wouldn't obviously touch any of this. But I do all my nutrition myself. Mm-hmm. So, like, I kind of developed over the my 15 year career how to do it. For making mistakes, my dad taught me a lot when I was younger. It's not rocket science, really. You just eat clean and. You eat clean, you stay away from processed food, processed sugars, and drink a hell of a lot of water. I drink 6 litres of water a day.
6 litres?
Without fail, yeah.
How long are you in the toilet for?
Oh, don't. Worst thing, you get into bed, you start getting comfortable.
I have that.
Comfortable.
Worst thing.
And fall asleep, and then you think about it and it comes on and you just think, oh, fuck this, I'm going to sleep. And you think, no, I better not, I might piss to bed.
You know what, the two things is, if you're working out, or in bed and you need a piss, I hate it. I absolutely despise it.
I've got a meal prep sponsor, the Body Kitchen UK.
Okay.
Sorts it all out for me and everything I need. So I'm lucky. He sends it to me every week. And I just stick to it. Like, at the end of the day, why am I going to cheat myself? That's what you've got to ask yourself. Why are you going to cheat yourself? Do you want to be a world champion or not? You know what I mean? And I've got applied nutrition on board. Sort me out on my supplements. So yeah, I'm quite blessed. I've got good people around me. Also, I've got Love Hemp. They help me out massively with the CBD oil drops. That has changed my boxing. Like, it's changed my way of thinking, my thinking pattern. I don't overthink things no more.
Yeah, talk to me about CBD. You guys are both on it.
We're
on it.
We're both on
I've given it a shot for like one process, and I can understand in sense of like when people say anxiety and stuff, and like sleeping, it helps calm you down a lot. But obviously, as full-time athletes, where do the benefits come the most?
With me, it helps me sleep. It really helps
you
me
always
sleep.
Used to struggle bad, like up all night.
I just never sleep. I just my mind didn't rest, and I wouldn't feel sorry for myself. I'd fall asleep at like 3 a.m, wake up and go and do track at 6. It just is what it was, and I was like that throughout the whole of my school life. I used to sleep at daft o'clock and then go straight and having to function. But Yeah, maybe it's a mix of that and obviously training, you know what I mean, steps up now I'm a pro. But I really like it. I actually used to vape as well.
Does that affect you? I was thinking about that because it's still some sort of...
You know what?
Because I've seen Fowler do it.
No, at the end of the day, right?
If you're not on it, you're behind. That's how I say it now.
If we're going to be like completely blunt about it, think of how many fighters you know that when they're at a camp going to sit in shisha bars, and which is going to be 1,000 times worse. You know what I mean?
Well, they say shisha's like... than smoking, yeah, which is surprising because I didn't think...
You just sit there constantly doing it, didn't you?
Yeah.
But it's one of those things at the end of the day. It's not like smoking like cigarettes, you know what I mean? And I don't know, I do it. My engine is always flying, so...
Is there anything in your diet, both of your diets, that you follow? Because this day and age, right, there's so many different... Yeah. There's like this keto, there's this, there's that.
Try and sell things.
Yeah.
Whatever works for you, and I'm not besmirching anybody's way they make weight, way their nutrition is. It strictly comes down to what you believe in. If you believe that's good for you, and you're doing it right, and it is working for you, and the success talks for itself, then why change it? Because someone says you can't do this, you can't do that. Like you're getting. I thought about getting a nutritionist on board for the first time. And when it come down to the wire, I was like, do you know what? No, I've never had a nutritionist. I've always performed mate weight wicked. I'm always in unbelievable shape. Yeah. I know how to do it because I am my own nutritionist, because I've made mistakes tenfold to my own body. I can't put my trust into someone telling me, eat this amount, this amount, this amount. Because then what if it fails at the end? Who's getting the blame? They're going to turn around and say, oh, he cheated. No, I never. But so I just do it my own way, and my own way's worked. So I'll stick to that.
You guys make... A massive drop. Flyweight is tough to, well, in your sense.
I've actually done it quite easy, to be fair. This time, the best I've made weight pronto ever, and it's at flyweight. Made it better flyweight than I did at superfly. Because I undivided every last bit, every attention detail, every supplement, every vitamin I took, every mineral I took, and I've done it, and I've done it very comfortably. To be honest, we was cracking laughs and going, oh, should we go down to light fly? Obviously, I wouldn't push it that much, but we was just cracking laughs because we did make it very comfortable. The only time I put a sweatsuit on was day before my weigh-in. The last
well, that's just so you get the water off for the least amount of time. Yeah.
I'm drinking 5 litres a day, I'm drinking 6 litres a day, cutting down fight week, and then just take some fluid out. But I didn't sit in no saunas. I weren't wearing sweatsuits or on runs. People cheat themselves when they're eating rubbish and then wearing sweatsuits to run and wearing sweatsuits 4 or 5 weeks before.
And they're just taking it out.
They're just taking it out of themselves. And then when you're putting fluid back in, your body's holding it and it won't reject it. So then when you get to fight week and you try and cut and you try and bang it off, you're in a bad place. And in this game, you don't want to be in a bad place.
So we've demolished the food.
It does smell a bit hot now.
We've demolished the food, but we're going to have a nice little extra few rounds with food. We've got spicy wings here. And we're going to ask Charlie and Sonny 3 questions, boxing related. And whoever, they're both going to try and answer it first. And whoever loses, or to win it, I don't expect you to know a couple of them, but if you come close, just 3. Shout 3, so.
So whoever gets closest.
Whoever gets closest, all right, gets a point. If not.
My brain's not functioning right now.
All right, let's go. So, the first question, you both, well, the whole talk about Klitschko's and you wanting to be like Klitschko, I thought, I'll throw a Klitschko question in there. What year did Vladimir Klitschko win his first world title?
1997.
It is, isn't it? I don't know. 1996.
1-0. 2000.
I was going to say 2001, but I thought, ah, you know what? No. You're just a snake now, trying to go one down.
This one will be easier, because it's not necessarily like a history question or anything. So be ready to answer quick. Name 2 other UK boxing brothers.
Callum Smith and Paul Smith.
Liam Walsh.
Shit. Liam Walsh. They're not related. Callum Smith and Liam Walsh ain't related.
I know.
Charlie Edwards. Oh, well, that's 2-0 there. Is that done, yeah?
We're going to do the third question just for...
Nah, because I'm 2-0 down. I ain't going to get back, am I?
Might be nice.
I don't think it's that hot.
Go on then, there's another one there for you to try.
Yeah.
I'm good.
Nice.
Nice.
It's technically one.
I'm gonna try it then.
It's only just gonna go in.
Oh, I love
it. Uh-huh. Oh,
yeah.
Warming up, right?
Yeah.
And the kickback's there for sure.
Well, one more thing to touch on. We've got head to head between you two. Just a bunch of questions. It's not a competition. Actually, yeah. We just get to know you a bit more. And it's just a bit more fun. So we'll throw some questions in. So, first question. Who's more intelligent?
All day long. He went grammar school.
He's thick.
I am.
We're not chalk and cheese. Really stupid.
Made it to the world title though, didn't I?
Ooh. Only because you came and trained with me. Smartest thing you've ever done.
Who'd survive in the jungle?
Very good reason. He's not a fussy eater.
Yeah,
I would starve, mate.
Is that the only reason?
One of the main reasons.
Yeah.
One of the big reasons.
Better cook.
I can cook though, don't get it
twisted.
I'm just lazy.
You can cook.
I can cook though. They rustle up a nice gram.
I think I know the answer to this question. Who's more of a party animal?
Someone. Who's out more? You, by far.
Out of a relationship, who's out more?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Well, I ain't.
But yeah. Nah.
We're both
like
an animal. We enjoy ourselves, you know what I mean? We don't take the piss, we're not a party yet, yeah. Do you know what I mean? But when we get the opportunity, we enjoy ourselves. You have to run a poll.
Run a poll.
That's a good question, we should do that to be fair. Who'd win? Edward versus Edward. Flyweight Championship unification.
Oh, I don't know, I struggled to get out to flyweight.
Oh, God. Why? That's a good question as well. Why would you beat Charlie? I know you wouldn't fight, but no. if you were
if the money was right.
Hold me the money.
Nice.
We can fix a betting on some drill.
Yeah, good. You go down in the fourth and don't get up.
That's
ball.
A good point.
No.
I heard the mic cut that.
Nah, we're different
fighters. That's
fighters.
A bit of a deep question to
ask
you, brothers, isn't
it?
I think there was a little disagreement here.
I'm trying to close up a fight. Look, I'm trying to make money as well.
Okay, who takes longer to get ready?
Yeah. I'm 5 minutes and done.
Oh, you don't even put gel in your head.
I don't even shower.
Or brush your teeth.
Straight out. Mm. He goes and gets his eyebrows done before now.
You can see you don't get yours fake, done. Fake that no. Eyebrow.
And you're one to talk.
I'm just gonna cut it.
The one thing I never wanted to get into was a fucking debate with you, fucking hell. Who's more independent?
I don't know. No.
Yeah.
Whose setup at home is more secure?
And it doesn't matter. Well, yours isn't really secure at the moment, is it?
Well,
yeah.
It is. My well, phone's secure. I live on my own. I pay everything my own.
Yeah.
You.
I choose not to do. I could do. Financially, you're ahead of the thing, but dependency-wise, I rely on less people than you do.
That's because you just sit in your room and play Xbox.
And still dependent, isn't it?
Who's faster in speed-wise, would you say?
Depends
if we're in camp.
No, are you talking about like running?
Sprint.
Or just in general?
In boxing, oh, in boxing terms.
No, his hand speed...
See, they can complement each other, though.
His hand speed is quicker, like... To just throw like multiple shots with my timing, I say my timing's better and
your
my reaction.
Your footwork's quicker. Now.
And my reaction is.
Completely two different fighters in some sense. It keeps it entertaining as well. You can selling the whole Edward brother scheme as well. I mean, you both bring two different styles to the table, so I guess it sells like that as well. And the last question, seeing as though we're in a restaurant and we've eaten food, post fight, who eats the most cheap meals? And who just loves their food?
Well, let's just say,
just look at body shapes.
I thought a week before him, I'm still on my cheat meals now, and he's back on healthy eating.
Apart from that.
So to finish off, we just want to speak on, like, genuinely moving forward. You're both in a really good position in your careers, and we all know it's a money game as well as achievement. What is it that you're both, I know you said mini Klitschko's, but what is it essentially that you're both wanting to prove within the next few years, not just career-wise, next few years?
Well, in the next few years, obviously, I'm not looking for a world title right now, but in the next 18 to 24 months, I think I will have fought for one. I'd be surprised if I hadn't. I've got a good promotional team, good management team, good world ranking out of the WBO, so I'm on the right path. I still want to clear domestic up a bit for a little bit for the next 12 months. I think that's my aim. I mean, there's some good fights out there that I can get some nice traction. Obviously, it'd be nice to end that sort of domestic scoop on a Paddy Barnes fight. I don't see it happening, but that would be sort of my ideal situation. So, yeah, just pick up a couple of titles, fight live on TV, get more of a buzz around me before when I do step up, you know what I mean, to the world level, then I've got more of like, more of a support, more of a platform, and obviously after winning that, it can push you on even further.
Yourself?
Well, in the next 5 years, like I said, my goal wasn't just to become a world champion. I want to unify divisions. I'm big for a flyweight, so, and I train solid and I'm dedicated, so I do want to go through the weights and I want to challenge myself and I want to win titles at as many weights as I can. I want to go down as a great, I want to build a legacy. First of all, I want to unify the flyweight division for sure, and I believe I'll be able to make flyweight for a little while now, a little while longer, and I'm looking forward to just taking over the division, but then it's where the opportunity comes up. Where the money is at, where the opportunity comes out, what arises. Boxing's a mad world, politics come into play and everything goes round in circles. But when I fought for this, when I called on this world title and took on the number one in the division, I'd done it because I believed in myself and I believed I can rule supreme now down at flyweight. And then after that, the world's my oyster, do you know what I mean? And only I could be my own person who would put any kind of what's the word? I'll be the only one who would be able to restrict myself. As long as I keep believing, as long as I keep training hard, as long as I keep listening to Grant and learning, the future is going to be bright. The future is going to be mega bright, and it's just about staying level-headed, feet firmly on the ground. I've got the best promoter behind me. and management team, MTK Global. Yeah. Got a great man in Grant Smith behind me. My team's nice and secure. Got very good sponsors who support me and stick by me emotionally as well as financially. And listen, the world's our oysters and we can go all the way.
It's mad, isn't it, if you think about it, because even like the top brothers that have come out in the past, like the Klitschkos, and they've left massive legacies. But imagine being like unified champs at the same division at the same time. Yeah. It'd be crazy. I don't think anyone's done it as brothers. It's history stuff that you both can do, and it's
we can make history. Like me winning that title made history. I'm the second British boxer other than Charlie Magri to win a WBC Flyweight title. So I've made history now, and now it's time to build a legacy and keep making history. And this guy's hot on my tail. And listen, we push each other, we try and outshine each other day in, day out in the gym, and we'll be all the way and we'll go to the top together. And that's what it's about. We're on the same wavelength and we can just keep going level to level to level. And we support each other through thick and thin, and we wouldn't let the other one fall off.
And if not, I'm sure we'll enjoy the journey anyway. Do you know what I mean?
It's all about enjoying the journey.
If you don't enjoy the journey, you'll never be content.
If you don't enjoy the process of something, yeah, whether you get to the pinnacle of it or not, you're gonna enjoy it regardless, because especially when you've got your own blood brother involved.
I think with me, I've only really learnt to enjoy the journey since I moved with Grant. I used to put a lot of pressure on myself about becoming a world champion, and now I've become a world champion, it's time to not relax, that's the wrong word to say, but it's time to go up another level now, but with no pressures and just enjoyment now. Yeah. It's about enjoying myself and really reaping my rewards that I've sowed.
It's exciting as well, because you're doing it at a time where British boxing, like we said, is on an all-time high.
Getting recognition a hell of a lot now. Yeah, exactly. And it's a great, we're lucky to and blessed to be a part of this.
Yeah, pioneers for them weight classes, and there's not been any in out of Britain that can make that much noise.
Brothers always make a bigger name because you bounce off each other.
Listen, we've It's been an absolute pleasure to have both of you on. You know, to take your time out as well. We know you both got a lot on at the moment. But yeah, it's been a pleasure, and we hope to catch up with you guys soon, man.
No,
cheers.